The final G, the most important G for me, is grit. Grit trumps genius every day of the week. You can be book smart, but it doesn't really help. It's grit.
I hope you're ready for this one and that you have your notebook at the ready, especially if you're a woman and if you're an ally of women generally. Because my guest this week is Debbie Wosskow, OBE, a woman who is the very definition of an entrepreneur, but she's backing women in the most powerful of ways. Debbie talks about these three G's. Oh my goodness. Graft, grace, grit. The magic of working hard, nurturing relationships, and basically able to deal with life's curveballs. And I have to say, I don't think I've heard anything in such a long time that has resonated with me so deeply. But also, it's made me really think about women in particular and how we're so uncomfortable with being comfortable about what we're great at and the light that we do shine in these few days on planet Earth, 29,000 days if we're lucky. And if you want to listen to someone who walks the walk and doesn't just talk the talk, Debbie's our woman. Debbie really understands her light, and it's really inspiring to listen to. So this is going to be completely eye-opening, and I can't wait for you to hear it. Enjoy.
Bow your head and let your eyelids close on down. Where we're going, you won't need to bring your frown.
Hi, I'm Holly Tucker, and welcome to my podcast, Conversations of Inspiration. I've reached out to founders and those who simply inspire me to share their hard-earned wisdom with you. My hope is that collectively, these remarkable realizations will help you on your own journey. I like to think of it as inspiration for life. So let's begin this week's conversation of inspiration. Welcome, Debbie, to Conversations of Inspiration. I have been looking forward to this since we put it in the diary, but actually you're a woman I hugely admire. And so I can't believe I'm actually getting to have this real quality time with you.
Thank you, Holly. That's a very lovely opener. Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here.
I'd love to just start getting into this, and I'm going to then talk about the small Debbie, but have you been running or walking today? Because I've read that fitness is important to you.
It is.
And I've got to say, I'm just on the journey. I'm in week four of running every day.
All right, amazing.
And I am feeling, I think, touch wood, the best I've ever felt.
Okay, I love to hear that.
How did that come into your life?
Well, I've always played sport and I was a gymnast when I was younger. And I'm a sort of conventionally A-type kind of gal and actually got very injured in a competition and smashed my elbow to smithereens when I was a competitive gymnast. So I've always had that connection between mind, body, and I think, you know, of course we go through periods of time in our 20s where we're not exactly prioritizing fitness, but I really think I've probably had a consistent 25-year stretch, and I'm 50, of recognizing that I am much better if I move every day. To the extent that teams in various companies that I've built have really instructed me, it's time for me to go and do it if I haven't. I'm also, I find routine very comforting.
Yeah.
I find routine comforting in times of change or extreme stress or push that we all have and that we women have. Mm-hmm. And so I get up and I train every day. So yes, I go to a gym that I love, and I love it because it's got awesome women there. And we women build networks anyway, don't we? So I've done business in those changing rooms and in my knickers. So I did the 7:50 a.m. strength and tone this morning, which is one of my favorite classes of the week because it's heavy, heavy weights. It's heavy weights as you possibly can. And I would never have done that in my 30s, I would have thought that that's what men did. I was going to bulk up, and it wasn't. That the older I've got, the more I love being really strong. So I was done with that. I got my frock on, and I try to walk everywhere, which for someone who loves high heels is a bit of a challenge. So I'm always swapping between. But I walked to my first meeting with my Better Menopause team, and then I've walked to be able to do this with you, and then I'm going to walk. So I like to get like as close to 20,000 steps a day as I can. But trying to manage the frock and the hair and everything is sometimes a challenge.
Yes.
But I find with those two non-negotiables, life's easier, brighter, more in control. I hate working out on my own because I feel like I spend my whole day telling everyone what to do. And I like to receive instruction. I really like a class because I'm sort of social and it's nice. I can meet people there. I've done business in classes. I've invited people who I'm doing business with to come do a class with me, which one I'm boxing and they're a bloke. It's quite funny. So I'm a bit frightening. But I think if you start the day the same,
yes,
then even when life isn't the same or when it's at its most challenging, that's given me an enormous amount of comfort and I like my routine.
I think that's fantastic advice, really fantastic advice. And well, I was only talking this week on my Instagram about the comfort of, for me, organization or that sort of, and actually it is getting into routine, but it is that organization and slight structure to what is not a structured life. And that's the thing. And you've also, this the year of turning 50.
Yes.
So huge congratulations. And
thank you.
This world that we're entering, I'm a few years off it yet, but I'm nearly there. Do you feel that you know yourself better than you've ever known yourself? We talk about the 20s and 30s. You've already touched on it. And do you feel that you're more confident now in making decisions that you know are right, but not just right, but you're listening to your gut more? You're actually basing that on not only the facts, but you're basing it on that experience. Because if that is the case, I'm wondering why we fear it so much. And is it a time that we should be celebrating?
I've always been pretty good at making decisions, almost too good, in that I do everything at pace. Mm-hmm. I think lots and lots of learnings in midlife, but I would say my big learning is to sit back a bit more. I am a nightmare for pushing to an outcome. I just want it done quickly. And that means sometimes that whilst you act on gut, being the quickest is not always the best. And that has been a really hard life lesson for me because my temperament is brand busy. Mm-hmm. So across every aspect of my life, trying to sit with things a bit more, find that really hard, kind of makes me itch, you know, I think is better. So I think I've always had a very strong inner voice, but part of that inner voice has been this sort of whirlwind, you know, and that's what people always call me, like I've arrived, you know, it's the whirlwind of activity and decisions and output and this and that. And I think I've got better, not at doing less because I've an absolute mortal fear of being bored, but of just sitting with decisions for longer. And then I think you do hear your voice perhaps more clearly in a long-term way. Maybe that's the kind of shift.
Gosh. I know what you're saying.
I'm just having to sit with it. And you know, AJ, Anna Jones, to give her her stage name, he's been my partner in crime for the last decade. We are both really trying to embrace that because she's the same.
Yeah.
And when you've got a business partner as amazing as she is, as we had at Albright, and we've sort of joined together in the Better Menopause, you're both like that. Then nobody's saying, hang on, just...
And probably pretty hard, right? That's the other thing for you. It's building those teams that do feel they have the confidence.
Oh, yeah.
Right? To be able to say, hang on a minute, you're doing your whirlwind thing again. I need you just to...
Yeah.
I know you need to absorb this more, absorb it more rather than decide.
Yeah, and I think I've probably got better at listening.
Yeah.
I think I always felt just work harder.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, like I can outwork anyone. That's one of my superpowers, but that's not always right, actually.
Yeah.
So I suspect I'm a different, and probably there are people I've worked with for long periods of time, you know, like a lot of the people who were with me at the beginning are still with me. I think they would probably say I've changed. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure necessarily mellowed, because I'm sure I still have my moments, but I think I'm recognizing that absolute speed of delivery is not always the right path. Mm-hmm. And giving things a bit more time to marinate, maybe in life. Maybe it's that.
I'm with you. And I love what you just said there. And it's just, I almost hear myself more in the marinating.
Yeah.
You know, and actually that in itself takes confidence, because I think it is, that's the beautiful diamond there, that actually you hear yourself more the longer potentially it's taking.
Yeah.
But actually to come out with a better outcome than maybe speed and execution, I completely resonate. I want to now, if we can, take a little step back in time, because I'm going to take the little Debbie back to Sheffield, because you came from a very
I've been there for a long time.
No, well, you came from a very entrepreneurial family. Your grandmother ran a chain of sweet shops and off licenses. Your father ran his own law firm, and your mother owned a printing and packaging business. So when you were sitting around having dinner, I'm thinking that everything, the conversation around the table, more than often would come around to business, would it? And was it, were you eating business from a young age?
Yeah, I mean, I think the point on that is those businesses were pretty humble. And I think that's the journey of the immigrant family gentrifying anywhere. All of my family across the diaspora, Eastern European Jewish immigrants to the UK. And I think when they make their way, they start with extremely humble businesses. So I grew up, and I would say my family had gentrified the generation before me. My mm-hmm. father was the first to go to university. He was a grammar school boy. He went to Oxford. He's a lawyer. You know, that happened in a generation. And I think, therefore, a lot of what I saw my grandparents doing was humble stuff. You know, in my extended family, people worked on the market, selling stuff. My grandfather had a, you know, selling like ladies' handbags from his car. And, you know, yes, I think, that's a lot of the conversation. And when you see the women in your life working and being mothers, and by the way, I didn't know anybody in my extended family who didn't do that, whether that was my aunt or my, I think you just have a real sense that that is normal.
Mm.
So I don't think a lot of what I went on to do as a young person, 25, when I started my first business, felt that risky, because I just saw everybody doing it. I didn't know anyone that went to work to do a job for someone else. Anyone. That just wasn't my experience of what people did. So, and if I look at my siblings now, and obviously I worked with my brother quite a long time in Love Home Swap. My next sister, Dan, is a psychotherapist, but she runs psychotherapy centers. That, you know, we're all like doing something. And I think, yes, maybe some of it's in the gene pool, of course, but I genuinely think a big part of it is it doesn't feel like a risk. And when I spend so much of my life, which I'm sure come on to, talking to female entrepreneurs, and, you know, that's one thing that you and I have a lot in common, Holly, is the desire to get more women doing it. And I wonder why I did and why it has never seemed like a particularly big deal. I don't mean it hasn't been like amazing and shit and equal measure, because of course it has. And the stuff that you just go, you know, stuff that you and I have been on the journey of fundraising and exits, and we'll talk about that. But
yeah, the magic.
But it didn't seem frightening, because that's what people did. Nor have I ever actually, and I mean ever, had an existential crisis as a mother as to whether I should work.
Mm-hmm.
Because,
again,
I didn't know any mothers who didn't work, right? So I think a lot of that you don't think about. And then you do things like write a book or do therapy or some combination of the two things, or be a parent. Now I'm a parent of teenagers, which is all of its own challenges. And you do think, why do I do this or think this? And a lot of it is just because that's what I knew.
It was normalized in your world, and having your own business, you know, for those listening, and, you know, so often it's all about the it seeming as being risky. If you're brought up in that way, it's not risky. It's what is normal.
Yeah.
And actually it allows you to go into it, and which is exactly what you did, because it was in the air that you were breathing, because at 15, you won Young Enterprise Award because you started your first business at 15 selling scrunchies.
Yes.
Which
was the 80s.
Yeah.
Although they're back, I gather from my daughter.
They are back. I've not put one in my hair. I did buy some, but I just sort of can't still do it. I can't go back there. So at 15, you started this sort of world. And again, did you sort of know, because we're going to swiftly move on to all your businesses, but did you know at that age? I think I did. I think I had a book that I used to write all my ideas down in. And they came often. But I sort of think I now look back and think I knew that I was going to work for myself, that that was my path. Did you know at 15?
Totally.
So everyone around you, though, must have not known that. So you have stuck it. Because think about it. When we go back in that era, you don't have people talking about entrepreneurism.
No. Look, I think there was a sense that, and this is again is conventional of immigrant families, I think, academic excellence was non-negotiable. So one of the main things about me is I'm a massive nerd. Like, I'm a huge nerd. I'm an academic nerd. I love books. Some of my greatest moments have come through engaging with books. I did philosophy. Like, I'm a very nerdy person, really, despite being able to manifest as an extrovert. Actually, if you stick me in the library in a stack with 20 books, so that's kind of my happy place, really. I mean, I've disconnected from that for a long time. So I don't know if that part of my brain works anymore, but that used to be my brain. So what's convention in immigrant families, I think, is you have to achieve, right? You have to achieve because we're a generation away from poverty. Mm-hmm. We're immigrants to a country. And in the case, I'm from a Jewish family, we're immigrants to a country where we feel safe. You have to provide your family with a brag book. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, you have to be like that. And all of my siblings are like that, actually. On the other hand, and something that I've said before, I'm sure my mother always loves it, but I would say I'm from a long line of proudly difficult women. Mm-hmm. Like, the women in my family are more easy, but they are women who get shit done. And that's what I've always seen. And that's what my sisters are like. So I think with all of that comes a sense of wanting to self-determine. You know, my mother would always say, you do what you want, Deborah, you always do, you know, and this, to some extent, she's sort of right, really. So I've always felt tenacious.
And how have you felt about that? You do what you want, you always have, because that slightly pinged me, because potentially people have said that in my family and about me, has slightly had a little moment.
But, yeah.
But how do you, you know, when Beyonce talks about bossy and this whole thing that we do, are you owning that more as you age?
Yes.
Less embarrassed about it?
But I don't think I ever really
You
was.
Weren't?
Not okay. really. I think I've always felt, because the other tenant, it's complicated being from such a, from a massive family, and there's a lot of stuff in the family, as there are in all families, and divorce and remarrying, and, you know, all that stuff that we learn to class as trauma as we get older. Mm. I think, and that sits often within the DNA of entrepreneurs, doesn't it? You know, it's very common for us all to have survived a thing or things. But I feel like my tenacity and sense of, if you can, you should. That's quite a big part of how I was brought up and how I feel. That if you can do a thing, this sometimes gets me into trouble because I tend to overcommit to too many things, because I've got this very well-developed sense of responsibility. I'm an eldest child, depending on how you cut it. There are seven of us, you know. If you can, you should means it's not always the easy path. Mm-hmm. I do have, and I have worked at having, quite a lot of ability. And some of that is a gift. You know, not everybody is born with an academic brain like I have. I just happen to have it. I'm not saying it just sort of happens, but I've always had it. So I had a real sense, you've got to do something with it. Like, it's not an end in itself, you know? So I think in that sense, I never really felt I had to dumb myself down. I suppose there have been points in time during my career where men have probably had a crack at it, you know,
of course,
to sort of get you to hide your light a bit. But in the end, my great energy and gift and joy in life has come from my sisterhood of amazing women that I've picked up along the road. And whilst there weren't a ton of us doing it at 25, actually, there were a reasonable amount of the people who are still with me 25 years later, you know, founders, Tamara Lohan from Smith or Martha Lane Fox, I was at university with, we were at it quite young.
Yeah, you were.
I think that peer group, probably of proudly difficult women, saying, just do it, do what you need to do, has been really significant for me. And I think those are the people that I turn to when I'm not sure, or when something terrible happens, which it has, because I think we're all very committed to, and necessarily so, our game face, which as women has to be absolutely intact at all times, right?
I'm going to try not make this podcast like 50 hours long, but because I need to get to now you going to university, but I just have to quickly ask you another question here. And if you can put it in a nutshell, in a way, when I'm talking to you already, and we're 20 minutes into this podcast, I'm already hearing someone where you rightfully are secure in your ability. You rightfully have no issue in talking about how you shine as a human being. And we're going to talk about women throughout this podcast. But just very quickly, I wanted to say, because some people are listening right now, by the way, and they might be going, "Cool, she knows who she is, doesn't she?" And I don't say boo to a goose. I do not shine. I know potentially what I've got inside of me, but I don't list off what I'm good at. Talk to me about that for a moment, because that is one of the things that is beautiful in you. But to other people, they're hearing that and they do not do that.
Yeah, so bloody start. Because no one's going to do it for you.
And that's what you've learned. No one does it for you.
No one does it for you. Do it for you. There are certain things I'm useless at. I am utterly unspatial. I couldn't reverse park a car if my life depended on it. There are parts of my brain that just don't function. But there are parts of my brain that hyperfunction. And I honestly think, I'm totally screwing up your order of events now, Holly. Sorry, but my very first job out of university was as a management consultant. I talked about this before. I was the bottom of my intake, which had two women in it. This is in 1995. By far the bottom. And it's the only thing in my life that I'd been bad at. And it was so good for me. For one main reason, I'm never going to prioritize spending my time on something I'm bad at again, right? I know what I'm good at. And I probably have had an early sense of what I'm good at. And I think having the funny academic education that I had, going to Oxford and all that, I think whilst the subject matter of what I learn is utterly irrelevant because nobody's ever going to ask me about Descartes' Cartesian circle or like any other stuff, I think what that does teach you is a few different things. You have to consume vast amounts of information really quickly and come up with a point of view. And if I have any skill set at all, I'm like the quickest reader on the block, right? So I just know how to get through a volume very fast and say, right, it's this, these are the things that matter. And the second is you have to be really good on your feet, because your whole academic life at that place, which is a funny place, it's not, evolved really in 1,000 years, is you are performing. You are reading out your crappy little 18-year-old essay to one of the world's greatest minds on your topic and trying to justify why they should care. And nothing prepares you for pitching to a room, and they're all men, by the way, pitching to a room full of male investors. If I really had to drill it down, then talking about Barclay and Hume, which I've never thought about before or since, as a 19-year-old, right? So I think Oxford gives you reading skills and performance skills, and it gives you, rightly or wrongly, a network. And I think as a young woman in business, it gives you a calling card, because when you launch in and you're asking men for money, which has been the soundtrack to our careers, Holly, for all of these years, it's a sort of moment where they go, particularly when you're 25 and you're sort of young and you look cute, all right, she's got a brain. So that would be how I would summarize that period of my life. But to go from that into the conventional thing, which back in 1995, you were either a lawyer, a banker, an accountant, or a management consultant coming out of a university like that. And I picked management consultancy because I had no money and it paid the most. And I was absolutely useless at it. It's the sweet irony of my life now that I'm a senior advisor to McKinsey. So I've obviously got better with age. But then a very early career failure, let's call it that, made me very clear, this is my skill set. I'm good at disseminating information. I'm very good on my feet. And I'm good with clients, I'm good with people, I'm good at selling, I'm good at, right, do more of that.
Yeah.
And one of my life lessons to women And in my book, I think I make like 6 pence from every book, by the way. So this isn't really a plug for the book, which really has taken us up to the latest. But AJ and I wrote a book called Believe, Build, Become, How to Supercharge Your Career. And the reason that we did it, which was an extremely painful exercise, by the way, was because we were always asked the same questions, right? How are you more confident? How are you so confident? How do you have an entrepreneurial mindset? How do you negotiate a pay rise? How do you network when you work? So that's what the book is, right? It's 12 chapters dealing with the stuff. And it's written like a magazine because AJ is a media publishing executive. She's currently the CEO of the Daily Telegraph. She used to run her. So it's written to be very interactive. And a lot of what we talk about in the book is figure out what you're good at for you. Write it down and do more of it.
Yeah. And then you can talk like Debbie is about what you're good at because you have worked that muscle over and over again. On Conversations of Inspiration, I only ever invite guests with fascinating stories to tell who aren't afraid to go there. People brave enough to be vulnerable and share that life isn't always as shiny as it appears. Those who show that to become successful, we have to experience some tremendous downs as well as the ups. Because isn't that ultimately what gets us where we need to go? It's why I've also built my marketplace in this way. Yes, you'll find thoughtful gifts for birthdays, anniversaries, and special occasions like Christmas, for example. But I also wanted to create a place where you could shop not just by department, but through emotion. The moments in life we don't always share with the world. A place that helps you celebrate the huge milestones, but also helps you find the words or the right gift when darkness creeps in and you don't know what to say. It's why we celebrate people's niches too, those funny things about us that makes us us. Whether you know someone who's really into wild swimming, passionate about birds, or just happens to love Munster Munch like I do. If this sounds like an interesting way to shop, I'd love you to head over to holly.co and explore. Now, back to our conversation of inspiration. You've touched on these things because you went on to study philosophy and theology at Oxford, and then you went on to the management consultancy, which is not necessarily your strongest point, but just straight out of that, because you knew it wasn't your strongest point, the entrepreneurial genes, the dinner table kicked in and you left and you launched your first business, Matra, a digital PR company with £3,000. Is that right?
Yeah.
So you now know what you think you're good at.
Yeah.
Yeah. But you are still 25.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I started NOS when I was 28.
Yeah.
As much as you know what you're good at, you're still young and you still haven't had life experience.
No, none.
You knew what you were good at. How did you get out there and make a success of it at an age where, you know, you will have doubts?
See, I don't have it, Holly.
Yeah.
I just don't.
Yeah.
I don't have why am I here? I don't deserve to be here. I don't. I think, fucking hell, I'm here. Like, come on, make the most of it.
Yeah.
I really do. It's a mindset thing. I mean, and I've done some ridiculous things, scary things where I have no right to be there, but I think it's a muscle.
And you worked it from 25 years old.
It was a moment in time. This is what I would say, because it was .com one, right? So it was 1999, end of 99, turn of 2000. So a few things, I think, set me up in that way. The first is, I think it's the first time, at least in recent economic history, where being young was seen as an asset, right? So everybody I knew, and I'd been at university with, and there were friends of friends, were starting startups, right? Nobody heard of startups.
Yeah, no.
Suddenly they were doing startups, and there were investors, and there was First Tuesday where you turned up and pitched, and, you know, it was that moment in time.
Yeah.
So it wasn't just me on my own. And maybe it's the same point as what did you talk about around the dinner table when you were 12? What I talked about with my friends who I spent my time with when I was 25 was very, very focused on starting up on your own.
Yeah.
One. Two, therefore, use a very trite analogy, but in the gold rush, picks and shovels, et cetera, et cetera. I started a service business that did not require me to raise capital, where my initial client set was a lot of people I knew who were young. So I think there was a moment in time where you didn't feel like that. And in fact, to build up that business to be a really big business as it was, and then by the way, 18 months later, for the revenue to utterly collapse when the dot-com market went into recession to rebuild. Of course, there was lots in there that I didn't know how to do, but I learned everything in that business. And I think services businesses are great first businesses. You're always two client wins away from greatness and two client losses away from utter unmitigated disaster. You learn everything about managing a P&L and cash flow. I check the bank account every day and still continue to do that, by the way, because I am that nightmare that wants daily sales stats. Mm-hmm. I learn everything, everything. I mean, we absolutely cocked loads of it up. Plus, we were just having a really good time at the beginning. Yeah. So, you know, we were burning all our money in Claridge's bar and like, but it was fun. But I think perhaps the reason I didn't have imposter syndrome is A, it's not really in my makeup, but B, a lot of the reason why I was getting an audience as we went on to work for really big companies was because I was young. You know, that was the point. A bit like now when I'm looking at across my different portfolio, and you will have the same, Holly, I'm like, okay, who's doing our socials? They need to be digital natives, or they're actually, my mindset is, well, they're a little bit old. You know, we need, who's handling our TikTok, right? You know, it's not someone my age, is it?
No.
It was the same thing then. So I think all of those reasons collided. I've always been good at asking really stupid questions and not caring about whether I look stupid. Mm-hmm. So I would say, don't understand that. Explain it to me. I've never really had a problem with that. Maybe because, I don't know why that would be. Why is that? Maybe because I studied philosophy is so hard. Like, you don't understand a lot to begin with. So you have to kind of ask, right? So I think I've always asked.
Yeah. Which again, us women tend to not do. Yeah.
But I think for me, environment has been everything. And there was a particular heady mix in the late 90s, early noughties that meant that your youth was an asset.
Mm.
And I was part of that wave. So for that reason, I didn't feel, why shouldn't I be here? I thought, this is exactly why I am here.
I mentioned I was 28 when I launched NOS, and you mentioned earlier the joy of fundraising throughout our careers. And it's been, you know, 20 years since I launched Holly & Co. and Not on High Street, 20 years apart. And so I wanted to ask you, you know, obviously I had, you know, funding the business throughout my career and throughout your career, you know, the significant challenges of raising money as female founders. And 25 years later, we're facing exactly the same challenges. You know, I'm in fundraising at the moment, and I'm not going to talk about it here necessarily, but I have been literally astounded at the lack of progress, the absolute lack of progress, and who I'm speaking to in terms of VCs versus, you know, individuals. You wrote about it recently, and as co-chair of the Invest in Women Task Force, what a title, by the way. You should have, like, I'm going to get you like a cape or something.
T-shirt. Yeah,
I've got a cape. Forget better, a t-shirt. Yeah. Okay, I have to basically say I clapped, I cried with laughter when reading it because I resonated. So tell me firsthand about the experience and the double-edged sword of struggling to raise money as female founders, which are mental, you know, crazy statistics, as well as, you know, the fact that we're trying to raise money with 11% of the VC world being women.
Yeah.
So it's, you're just doubly fucked, yeah, basically, yeah, on the whole thing. And it's something that is been throughout my last 20 years.
Yeah.
And I'm doing it again. And it's almost like 2006 all over again.
Well, this is my chosen specialized subject, Holly, as you know. So
this is your mastermind
subject. Ask me any stat. So I'll give the kind of arc of history and then what I'm trying to do. So the single reason I have succeeded in my career is because I'm really good at asking men for money.
Mm-hmm.
If I wasn't, I wouldn't have had a career.
Yep.
Because I've never had to have the opportunity, really, of asking a woman for money. So, you know, we need to be clear that we are not at the table. Women do not invest. 11% of venture capital investment committees are female. 14% of UK angel investors, but it's on the slide. And then the latest stats, which were my big announceable with our first female chancellor last week, are that in the first half of 2024, the amount of capital of the 8 billion invested in the UK going to back an all-male team went up from 80% in 2023 to 86% in 2024.
Oh my God.
Whilst the amount of capital going to back a female powered business, like a business led by a woman, went down under 2% to 1.8%. And it sat around the 2% mark for as long as I can remember. So there are some hugely structural issues that mean it is just harder for women. In the main, women, not always, but mostly, found businesses that solve problems that affect their and other women's lives. And that's different to male businesses. One of the reasons that the stats were so bad this year is that the very big fundraisings happened in AI. Only 7% of AI founders are women. And the majority of capital raises were later stage. And the missing middle in venture capital shows that whilst the stats are terrible across the board, they are significantly worse post-Series B and beyond, where women just are nowhere on either side of the table. They neither invest nor do they get that. So to the point on if you can, you should, and stand for something, I feel strongly that the voice of the female entrepreneur in politics and in decision making needs to be heard. And I like politics. I'm kind of nerdy about politics. And I did a government review in 2015 called the Wosskow Review into the Sharing Economy when I had Love Home Swap. And that did some good stuff. And I kind of understand on a basic level how you get that to work, how you drive political change through having a voice and bringing other people along with you. So I was appointed in March to co-chair an initiative that I've been talking to the then Conservative government about for a long time, which is we are spectacularly bad at this as a country. We're like 28th in a global league table. And we can talk about it as much as we like, but the only thing that's going to create a generational shift in capital allocation is to create incentive. And the incentive has to be that there is a wall of money to back more female investors mm-hmm. with a mandate to back women-led and mixed teams. In other words, fund the funds, make it genuinely possible for women to raise funds, because at the moment it is impossible for lots of structural reasons. Make it also a point that when funds exist, it is important that they allocate money behind female decision makers with a mandate within those funds to back female-led businesses.
Yep.
And make this a really great place to do business. Yeah. And there are a lot of very live political conversations at the moment that make us as entrepreneurs feel it's going to be less good, right? If there's a wall of money that's there to back female investors, why wouldn't US and European entrants come and base themselves here? And the capital can only be deployed in backing UK businesses run by women or a woman. So male co-founders are welcome, mm-hmm. but it's got to be real. Can't be bullshit. Can't be some yeah. thing where yeah. it's not really women. So I was appointed to co-chair that in March with an excellent woman called Hannah Bernard, who runs Barclays Business Bank, who is the yin to my yang. She's a proper grown-up executive banker. And our appointment was confirmed by our first female chancellor last week. And we're very close to announce with this initial target of a 250 million funding pot, which will be the biggest funding pot in the world to back female investors with a mandate to back women-led businesses.
Woo! I'm just going to say, this is just, yes.
So it takes a village.
Oh.
So it still is the case to make that happen, that one of my superpowers of being good with men and money has to be deployed. So I've got to persuade the pension funds and the investment banks to contribute to the LOI.
And what do you say to them when you're persuading them?
Yeah.
We don't have the time for the whole thing, but what's the nutshell when you basically say it's worth backing it?
I say it's profit plus purpose, because guess what, boys? Women-led businesses deliver 35% better returns than male-led businesses. So, you know, you need to get behind it, but there's also some money to be made. And then I think it's pressure. It's reading the political room.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're in a new era. And I have to say, you know, I hosted an event at Downing Street number 11 last Wednesday with Rachel Reeves. And I spoke as she spoke about this topic, because she's now our political champion. And I've done a lot of this kind of thing, Holly, and I'm sure you have too, where I've been in there to number 10 or number 11. And to be in an exclusively female room
mm-hmm.
in number 11, hosted by our first female chancellor, talking about something very specific, which is investment, not just like, I've been to loads of these things and you will have too, Holly, on International Women's Day tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, yeah. I'm not like great and everything, but actually this wasn't that. This was like, there is a wall of money. It has government support. The reason that we're doing it is because if women founded businesses in the UK at the same rate as men, it would be an additional $250 billion to UK PLC. To have that conversation framed in those terms felt to me like a big moment.
Huge.
Because we can't just be at the table because it's nice or because people should. We're at the table because women should be rich, right? And we should talk about money and we should deploy our capital in backing other women. Because God only knows that's what the men do. So we've got to have a breakthrough moment. And I hope, and I feel, I'm going to say confident, that this is it.
Please let it be it. Please let it be it. Yeah. Thank God you're doing this. This is, you know, this has been like for any woman, it's basically impossible. You know, my situation, having created Not in the High Street, exited, created all that wealth for so many people.
Yeah.
You would think, you know, 20 years on with that experience, that you can basically get the funding you need from the right places that you need it from. It's not. It's impossible. Because you're talking about the 11% that you might not want to get either. You might not want to go down the VC route. But if you do, it's 11%. And we're talking about the fact that it's gone down to 1.8% of women actually getting it. You might never see that 11%. It's literally an impossible game that we're playing here. And yet you said profit and purpose, because that's one of the things that I see from my networks and things. Women have this ability to create business, but also to be able to frame and change society or take causes and move things forward. We see the rise of ESG businesses. You know, it's an amazing thing that women do. And you say about 35, that number, 35%. Is an incredible thing that I'm listening to you say that. And after 20 years of it nearly killing me, it's shattered my life in so many ways. Asking men for money to build a business that inherently for 20 years has been 98% women, 98% women consumers, 98% women small businesses, 98% women team, and yet 100% male money.
Yeah.
And so what are we to do? And yet we're all sitting here right now, you being this amazing woman doing this, but we're all sitting here trying to grow businesses, trying to do this with those sort of statistics. It's a pretty depressing thing.
Yes. And I do feel like change is coming. I also feel like I just closed an investment round for the Better Menopause, which is the business that I exec chair. I'm the majority shareholder, which is science-driven supplements for perimenopause, menopause. And two observations around that. We had set out to have as close as possible to a predominantly female cap table. Now, Anna and I tried to do that all right. We were off our rockers. We would have funded one of the loos and one of the, like, you can forget. That was a nice idea. Forget it, right? So, no. The beautiful thing about Better Menopause is the products are amazing. We've got four or five more coming out. They're direct to consumer. It's about science and education and changing women's life and midlife. It's also less capital intensive, right? Never again am I doing this thing where I have to raise tens and tens of millions of pounds because of all of the reasons that we know. Yeah. And actually, as an entrepreneur, you can end up in a difficult situation, right? Yeah. Where the cap table has a life of its own. So I think to your point on what happens with age, I think you get very clear on where's the EBIT. You know, I think more than either of us would have done 20 years ago, Holly, because to some extent, I've been fortunate with the way that things have landed. I've been creative in the business model, but I think starting again at my age, you're like, okay, I see the audience, midlife women. I see the need. It was a personal need because I'd had my own burnout. I don't love the term, but you know, I got sick.
We're going to get to that.
But I was very focused on where's the money? Where's the margin? How can I raise as little money as possible in order to drive profitability? And can I bring women in the cap table? Now, it takes longer because women write smaller checks. Why do women write smaller checks? Because the gender pay gap begets the gender savings gap. We just got less money, right? So if you're raising, we've got two female angel syndicates in the cap table. We've got a lot of amazing exited female entrepreneurs whom I love, whether it's Tam from Smith or Vivian from Little Moons or Grace Beverly, or it takes a bit more work, but you can do it. when the quantums are smaller. And then two is there are some enlightened men in the cap table.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, without them, mm-hmm. and you and I know lots of the good ones, Mark Asari, et cetera, et cetera.
Yep.
It would be a lot harder. So I think in all of this, and this was a big mantra, Albright, none of this is anti-men. Mm. You know, our male allies and our male champions are a big part of the way that we get these things off the ground. But if we can give women a share in the upside, that's the other way that we're going to change the conversation, right?
I couldn't agree with you more. Grit, grace, graft. Graft, grace, grit.
Yeah.
Tell me about this, because I loved this when you shared it. And I actually just can't. Yeah, I can't agree with you more. This combination, I got goosebumps when you said it. Explain those three words and why you believe in them so much for female entrepreneurs.
So I'm very simple, really, you know, simply minded. I find
sort of, well, Debbie, you can say that to yourself.
As I get older, I like, okay, I'm that. But I like simplicity and I get asked to speak a lot. So I try to find ways to make things memorable, right? As I've tried to distill what matters to me, what are my values, what do I look for? Because I invest a lot, as mm-hmm. you know, and I think it's these three G's. So, and I'm a northerner, as you, even though I don't sound like it anymore. So I think graft, I don't know if we talk about it enough. It's just really hard work, right?
I don't think we do.
You know, it's just hard
Absolutely
work.
Absolutely
not. And that's not right. hustle porn. It's just hard work. Mm-hmm. You've got to pull hard. You just got to put the hours in. There is no shortcut. It no matter how much experience you've got, you've got to work hard and you've got to have the appetite for hard work, and not everybody does. Mm-hmm. AJ and I always say, you like, we WhatsApp from first thing in the morning to last thing at night. You have to find that fun. I find it fun. You know, I find like, oh, yes, and there's an idea and there's a thing and we could do this, we could do that. I find that gives me energy. If that level of input makes you feel exhausted or frustrated or as if you don't have the appetite, like, forget it.
Don't do it.
It's just volume. Mm. So I think that graft point is a point. I think the second G for me is grace. That's also my daughter's name, although she's Gracie. What comes with age, I think, is grace under pressure. Sometimes it's hard, mm-hmm. particularly when you're impatient. I'm very impatient. But I think the thing that stood me in almost the most stead has been my relationships, never burning bridges, keeping people in my life who've been in my life forever, saying thank you, you know, like being there for reaching out, seeing how people are, checking in, being responsive. And that's really hard because a bit like you, I have this kind of, well, particularly my LinkedIn sort of alter ego, and I get a lot of incoming and you can't really reply to people. But, you know, trying to. So I think that grace and graciousness, gracefulness is important.
Yes.
But the final G, the most important G for me, is grit. Grit trumps genius every day of the week. You know, you can be book smart, I'm book smart, but it doesn't really help. It's grit. And I'm not a reader of business books at all, so I'm a massive consumer of fiction, and that's my happy place. But Angela Duckworth's book on grit, I think, is a phenomenal book, because that is the point of difference. And I think when you listen to someone speaking on a podcast like this, or you look at them on social, or you hear their story and it all sounds effortless, it was absolutely not. There were moments of despair. There were moments where we had £1,000 in the bank account with payroll due the next day. There were moments of personal crisis. There's been everything. But the thing that gets you through is grit. And I think grit can be learned. I think that a lot of what we started the podcast talking about routine and fitness, and, you know, I think when all around you is in flames, it's your routine that gets you through, and it's your sense of self. Mm-hmm. And I've always backed myself, even when I really felt like it, right? You know, things have just felt too hard. And there's a big thing in that, which I think is something else that may be worth sharing, useful for people to hear, is when absolute Armageddon happens, and it has, when things have gone so wrong, well known, I was a single mom when my kids were 3 and 1, that was most definitely not the plan. I give myself 24 hours to feel sorry for myself.
Okay.
right? 24 hours of lie, it's not fair.
Yeah.
Punch the pillow,
yeah.
Cry, scream, punch the punch bag in my case, whatever. And then I'm like, right, you're done.
Okay.
You're done. Like 24 hours and then you're done. You have to pull yourself up because I've got amazing friends. I've got my siblings and I are super close, but nobody is doing it for you apart yes. from you. They're just not.
Yes.
So give yourself 24 hours and then be done.
What a great piece of advice. So I don't know if anyone's asked you to summarize your three businesses in 10 minutes.
Yeah.
You sold your first business.
Yeah.
As you said, you were a single mum.
Yeah.
You decided to take your kids on holiday. And it was during this trip that you watched one of your favorite films in the world.
Yeah.
The way we share that, the holiday. Because it's not a popular, great film,
cheesy.
Right?
Yeah.
Because everyone really doesn't like that is my favorite film,
okay.
but it really is.
I
and you had yeah. this light bulb moment and yeah. you became the founder and CEO of Love Home Swap.
Yeah.
You then moved to find Albright.
Yeah.
And then you've moved on to now what you're doing.
Yeah.
Can you take us and just after Albright, the moment where you found yourself in hospital.
Yeah.
But if you could take us from Love Home Swap into that journey, I would be so honored to hear it.
Okay, so that's sort of like a 12, 13-year arc, I think. So
yeah.
Love Home Swap was exactly that. I was on a plane. I watched the film The Holiday. And then 5 years later, I sold the business for 53 million. Sounds really easy, right? You know, look, I mean, what was the point on that? One, I think inspiration can strike at any time. Just got to be open to it, have your eyes open.
Mm-hmm.
And I think maybe there's an interesting pause or moment around what I do after that. People ask me that a lot. So my process, such as it is when I have an idea, I've got to not be able to not stop thinking about it.
Yeah.
Because I would really share that piece of advice. And I don't know how you feel about it, Holly, but
obsession.
Right. You've just, because also if you're not really into it at the beginning, like, believe me, by 2017,
like a child to
yeah,
you.
Because by 2017, so 5 years later, five and a half, standing in front of the stills of Kate Winslet and Cameron Diaz, pretending there was the first time I'd ever told the story about the inspiration, but like I felt like I was going to flipping scream my head off. So if you don't like it at the beginning, you're not going to like it by the end, right? So I think sort of restless obsession. And then look at the economics. So, you know, you sense there's a market. Is there a market? What's the competitive set? You know, the businesses I've built have been digital first. What are the economics? Really basically, how would you bring in a customer? What would you have to pay? What could you charge? Is there profit, right? You know, again, mm-hmm. that's the point yeah. of simplicity. And then can you get together a 10 to 12 slide deck that could convince anyone to give you money? And look, there's been some stuff in that bucket that just hasn't stuck, right?
Mm-hmm.
But Love Home Swap was a moment in time. I also did it with my brother, which was really important. My youngest brother, Ben, who was about to go and do an MBA, and I dissuaded him, and I couldn't have done it without him. That was an important part of it. We were right place, right time. Platform is everything. You know, that's when I did my government work. I chaired Sharing Economy UK. I had a reason to talk about the business a lot. I've always tried to find one of those. My old chairman, who I love and still work a lot with, said to me, Deb, sometimes being early is the same as being wrong. And we just timed it, right? Like, I haven't always, but we just timed it, you know? So I guess that was that one. Albright was a beast.
Yeah.
It was the best thing I've ever done. It was the worst thing I've ever done. We had buildings in the US. We thought we were doing something, and then the pandemic took our revenue from exponential growth to zero, and I mean zero, overnight. Couldn't fly to the US for 20 months. Like, we've all forgotten what it was like, but, yeah. you know, there were two businesses.
I was only talking about it the other day.
Two business lines you didn't yeah. really want to be in, and they were sort of hospitality and travel. It was super hard. The power of resilience, the power of community, the power of partnership, you know, AJ and I will be always in each other's lives. And a big part of it was that. It was just so hard and so bonding. How to get an outcome, even if you think there isn't one. But the red thread, Love Home Swap, predominantly female audience, Albright, focus on women's careers.
Which is, for those who don't know, it's a female club.
Sorry, yeah. So it's members clubs and a digital platform for women's careers, and it became an absolute monster. Anything to do with women in careers, we were doing it because we were trying to figure out how to make money, right? So we were doing upskilling programs and digital platforms and like, oh my God, absolutely everything. We got our exit in 2022. And then what am I trying to do now? So July of 2022, I was in hospital. I had bacterial pneumonia and pleurisy. I was really ill. Never been ill, don't do ill, always been really hard driving. Everything just caught up with me. I'd been flying. Part of the amazing and awful of Albright was I flew to the US twice a month. And because my kids were little, I'd fly back.
Gosh.
You know, things that we can just normalize.
And this is this burnout moment, even though we don't like the word.
I just run out.
You think this, your body basically had another idea.
Yeah. You know, body keeps the score, right? You know, I've never really believed it until mine did, because I always thought I could outwork, out-train, eat more protein, I'd be fine.
Yep.
And I really, really, really wasn't. And I was poorly for quite a long time afterwards, couldn't really get better. I was on antibiotics for ever.
I read that you couldn't even walk down to the end of your road in the end.
I mean, I'm not joking. And bear in mind, I can like bench press 200 kilograms. Yeah. And I couldn't even get to the end of the road.
Yeah.
It was so humbling, is overused, but it was like, okay, I need to listen. I need to make some changes. I need to change the way I work. I need to change the way I think about exercise. And I definitely changed that up. I do a lot less HIIT and cardio than I used to, because and a lot more strength and even stuff like yoga and Pilates, which I always thought was a waste of time. So I've kind of mixed it up.
Mm-hmm.
But if your eyes are open, if you're a nutter, opportunity comes at funny moments, right? So so I was in with the doctor, with the gastroenterologist, and he's like, part of the reason your bloods are this, and you've done this, and part of the reason you can't feel any better is because you're in perimenopause, because your gut health's been so compromised because you've been on antibiotics for so long. And I'm like, say that again? And then I get my laptop out and he's like, oh God, this woman's insane. And I'm like, just say that again. And I'm like, why? I'm pretty well informed, I would say. And so are a lot of the women I know. One, I've never heard of perimenopause. I feel quite insulted. What do you mean? Kind of thing. I've got a six pack. And two, so is there a connection between gut health and women's hormones? Why don't I know about that? I know about the Zoe app and I know about the gut-brain continuum. I know about Huberman. I know, because I'm kind of a health nerd, but I don't know about that. So why aren't people talking about that? One, and two, what can I do? So if I've got a compromised gut health that's impacting my hormones, that's causing me to go into earlier menopause, that I was 48 by then, what do I do? And he's like,
I mean, how shocking.
Take a probiotic. And I'm like, okay, what's the probiotic then that's tailored for women in this? And he's like, there isn't one. So I'm like, okay. So I come out, phone agent, and I'm like, okay, this is the net, we're doing this. And she's like, oh my God, can you ever? But
can you,
and,
you can know, you, yeah.
And that.
Can you definitely just stay in your burnout state, yeah, possibly?
Be burnout. But that, you know, in a year and a bit later, that is the better menopause. So we are developing science-driven supplements that are there for women in midlife to ensure that they feel like themselves again. Because that's what I wanted. I didn't feel like me and I wanted to feel like me again. So we have two products so far, Better Gut, which is the hero product. That's the first probiotic developed for perimenopause, menopause, and Better Night, which is our sleep product. We launch in the US in a few weeks' time. And then in January, our next product's out, which is called Better Metabolism. And we're building out through a range of products that we develop with Dr. Park, who's one of the big menopause doctors in the UK, Joanna Lyle, who's a clinical nutritionist, for products that have scientific use cases that change the experience of women in midlife to make them feel like they can do whatever they want to do. Because the stats around midlife women, to me, with my sort of red thread around women, work, and money, 25% of women in perimenopause, menopause want to leave the workforce because of their symptoms, and 10% actually do. And that was a killer stat for me. I'm like, hang on a minute. It's so hard.
This is the best bit of you.
To keep women in, but this is the good bit. You know,
this is the bit where you've just been working to.
You've worked to this for those of us who've had kids, and depending on when we had them, we're coming into our own, we're coming into our brilliant second act. I don't want women not getting the support they need to feel like they're on best form. And that's what this business is about.
Dell Technologies are passionate champions of small businesses. They recognise that it can be a lonely road, and so they have the Dell Women's Entrepreneur Network, or DWEN for short, which is a worldwide community of over 100,000 female founders. They run free events and mentoring programmes and have a network of brilliant women all connecting and sharing insight. They also recognise that for many small businesses, visibility is one of the biggest challenges they face when trying to reach new customers. So each week, Dell give away their ad break space. So now I'm going to hand over to this week's winner of Dell's independent ad break.
Fed up of stress and mess during baby mealtimes?
Introducing Chomp, a multi-award-winning, inspirational children's tableware company designed to bring more style, ease, and a sprinkle of magic to mealtimes, supporting your little one with their positive transition to solid food. Chomp is a small British business created by a mum fed up of being surrounded by primary coloured plastic dinnerware that didn't support her son through this important stage of babyhood. Inspired by her own experiences, Chomp supports families through reducing stress and mess with the weaning milestone and beyond. Come and see our stylish dinnerware collection at chompbaby.com and join our growing community of parents on Instagram at chompbabyofficial. We are actively seeking retail partnerships. If you are a retailer in this space looking for a fresh, award-winning baby brand that supports families at mealtime, please email us hello@chompbaby.com to find out more about what we can offer.
Thank you, Dell, for your support and generosity. If you'd like to find out more about DWEN and connect with brilliant and inspiring women, or you'd like to be in with a chance to have your very own ad break here on this series, head to holly.co/Dell. Now, back to this week's conversation of inspiration. Do you think that there is conversations that can happen within the sphere of women that also can be detrimental? So just a conversation about labelling.
Yeah.
So, for instance, you know, like yourself, International Women's Day, being asked to do panels on my imposter syndrome and, you know, all the things that I might have and my dyslexia and all this sort of stuff. And then, and I'm not saying either one is wrong, but then we go into basically menopause, continuous menopause that we should have, you know, within the workplace now, we've got to have all the abilities to cope with menopause. Yeah. Do the women have fans on their desk? Now, the thing is it can work. When we talk about the statistics that we've just been talking about and everything stacked against you, is this a good thing? It's great you and I are talking about it, and every single woman listening now are going to go and look at your supplements and and the fact we're talking about it, the fact that 3 or 4 years ago, we wouldn't be having this conversation. So it's fantastic. And my son understands that I am entering the menopause now. And so he understands that this just doesn't happen. Mm. My mother never even mentioned the word menopause ever. So it's great. But do you think some of these things can also work against us?
On balance, I take this, by which I mean openness, conversation, advocacy, awareness. And I tell you why. HRT in the UK is now free, or almost free, on the NHS. And in the US, it isn't. And I'm very aware of this because I'm launching the business the week of the 14th of October in the US. So 50% of women who can and who want to take HRT in the UK do. It's 5% in the US. It's a funny one where we are actually, and it is the Divina effect, we are more advanced in this country in the last probably 2 years in having the conversation than almost anywhere in the world. And that never happens.
Yes.
So one, I feel like I take that actually.
Yep.
Two, I feel like having a language is the most important thing. Mm. And education is as important. And I would take that. So similarly, when I said to my mother, when did you go and to menopause, didn't know anything about it. And my mum was like, well, we just didn't talk about it. you know, did you take HRT? Mm. Of course not. It wasn't a thing, you know. So yeah. I would take development. I suspect it will calm down. And I think that what I have seen, however, as I move through the business life cycle of better menopause, is men recognizing that it is a topic that's only going to grow in importance. And I think that's really powerful when we look at
yes.
how underinvested women's health is as a category.
Yes.
Now, do I feel like, you know, some of the boards that I sit on the board of Channel 4, for example, which has a fantastic and high profile CEO, Alex, you know, it's a very, very live topic there. And they have led the way in a lot of the workplace accessibility points that they've put mm-hmm. in place. How do I feel about that? And part of me, of course, shares that. Well, do we really want to be branded and doesn't mean we get blah, blah, blah. But on balance, I'll take it.
Yeah, I agree. I just wanted to ask the question because, you know, that you know, we have, there's still eye rolling.
Yeah.
And so I just wanted to ask that question. I mean, everyone, we're all just waiting for you to say, not very good at that, except I can just bench press 200 kilos. But, you know, except I'd love the philosophy. And I'm like just thinking, crikey, it's a tall order. But we need people like you. We need people like you to hold up there. I need someone like you to hold up there and be my star, because this means that it is going to be possible. If I just keep in your tailwind somewhere, finding you wherever your tornado goes, you know, that is what we're going to be able to do. I want to ask you one final question before I ask my standard questions at the end of this podcast. What legacy do you want to leave?
Well, I think this is my legacy, Holly. You don't need my tailwind. You create your own. You just have to see it, honestly. And I think, again, as a books nerd, I hold certain books or certain, I've got a quotes memory. I've got a funny memory. So, you know, things that stay close to me. And I'm one of the greatest female writers of the last 20 years is Hilary Mantel, who wrote the Wosskow trilogy, which I love. So I love history. And she writes one of my favorite historical characters so beautifully, Oliver Cromwell, and all of his tenacity and duplicity. You know, he's a sort of extraordinary, the role of the advisor. It's very fascinating. And there's a quote that she puts into his mouth in Wolf Hall, where he says, the things you think are disasters in your life are not disasters really. Almost anything can be turned around. Out of every ditch, a path, if only you can see it. Mm. And that's my thing, right? So if I have any sort of legacy, of course, it's the investing in task force and the money. And the, I think I can do it, Holly, I do. And I think if I can make that happen, then the trickle-down effect is so significant and changing a market where I've spent my whole career, while some time in the US. But I think this sense of out of every ditch a path, and I've faced shit tons of ditches, Holly, I really have. Mm. But I think women need to believe, and I think we need to change the narrative. You know, what I always call women out on is we are not aided by self-deprecation or a lack of self-belief. Own it. So I'm good at this stuff.
We are coming away with owning our stuff.
Own it.
I'm telling you now. I'm going to ask you two questions. So this has been a roller coaster for you. It is, you know, very, very much your ditches and your lows and your highs have been extreme. And there's been so many more ditches, 90% ditches to your 10% highs, I'm sure, or 1% highs, 99% ditches. If it was like a roller coaster, would you tell me what has been Debbie's lowest moment on the roller coaster?
Oh, God. I mean, you know, it's always personal life catastrophes, I think, that are hard. I think we feel that, however Teflon we are in the workplace. Actually, I find it much easier to be tough at work than I do in my home life. You know, I think that's easier, isn't it? Because we're kind of playing a role.
Yeah.
So I think it's the basic stuff around being on your own and being on your own with kids and feeling like you've made the wrong choice. And I think that stays with you always because you have children with the person that you're not with and the consequences of that for them are very meaningful. So I feel like that stuff is almost harder. Of course, I've been, you know, running Norbright through the pandemic or before I did the investment round from Love Home Sort and I thought it was going to go bust and it didn't. There's all of that. But in a way, that's the game.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the game.
Yeah.
Right? Your life, your actual life, your relationships, your children, little kids, little problems, big kids, big problems. You know that one, honey. You know, that's the stuff that is our heart, I think.
And conversely, can you name something when I say to you on that roller coaster with your spirit and the wind in your hair, can you tell me what you would say would instantly be one of your greatest highs?
Well, look, the highs are high, but you know, full financial independence is the point.
Yes.
I mean, it's a weird moment. You know it because you've had an exit and I've had a few, and the money drops in the bank account for the first time and you're a bit like, okay, I've done it. It feels very odd, you know.
And then 24 hours later, you're on to the next thing.
Yeah, okay, maybe because I think we're defined by the stuff, aren't
yes.
we? But I Absolutely. Think those highs are tremendously high. Of course, yeah. that is the high. But then you also have highs in every day. I do. And I still find a lot of joy in momentum. I find joy in the little wins. I think that's the other thing, actually. Somebody once said to me, and I can't even remember who it was, you have to celebrate the little win. If all you're doing is waiting for the exit.
Yes.
Like, it's a flipping miserable yeah. journey, right?
Yeah.
So,
yeah, and you could be waiting a while.
Indeed.
It's the little milestone moment.
You have to. Every Absolutely. New product launch, every team win, every time someone in the team does something great, every time something yeah. happens, yeah. you have to mark it.
Yeah.
I'm not always good at that because I'm always on to the next thing, but I think I've got better at that with age too.
You've been amazing, Dick. I mean, geez, we have learned a lot. I have learned a lot. I've been nervous about this conversation because I hold you in such high regard. And actually, you are one of those Beyoncés to me. You are one of those women I really do just follow what you say. And you've been phenomenal for me in my lifetime. Can I hand over to you, the formidable woman that you are, to read something to Debbie when she was still confident, but potentially not as confident as you are today, to your letter to your younger self?
Okay. Okay, we ready?
We're ready.
Right. Dear Deborah, because yes, you are mostly Deborah at this age, especially when you're in trouble with your mother. Don't be quite so hard on yourself. An A- is okay sometimes. Books are and will be your great friends, and that will never change. When all else fails, shut the bedroom door and read. Words matter. When you make it to the theatre the first time, you will truly fall in love. It's not always easy being the eldest in a house full of difficult women. It will make you. It won't break you. Develop a rhino hide. Lead. It's okay. Get on the stage and speak. Be heard. There'll be a lot of that to come. Stand for something and don't worry if everyone doesn't like it. They won't always, but you'll worry about it less. Your brother and sister are important, even in a vast, sprawling, dysfunctional tapestry of steps and siblings and all the rest. They will always be with you on the bus, in life and in business. As you age, even more so, and their children and yours will have their own special networks. Keep grafting. You can outwork anyone, and sometimes you'll need to. Spread your wings and get out of the north, on planes and on trains. Be in the world and have adventures. Don't worry about boys. Pick more wisely, to be honest. Probably better husbands, but you're too young for that right now. Your sisterhood will be the thing anyway. Keep making friendships and picking up amazing women along the way. When you turn 50, they will all be there. You need to expect that. Let me have water. I did this in my 50th as well. It will bring you great joy. Learn about grit. You have anyway. You don't know it yet. Remember that it trumps genius every time. And be graceful. You'll name your daughter after that one. And grace under pressure is the thing. Fight, but keep smiling. You'll get there. And the road will be bloody bumpy. But the first act will be awesome. And here's to the second.
When you read that, I think of you in a bus leading the way. I think of the sign on the front saying sisterhood. I see the number plate at the back saying grit. And I see all us women on your bus with you leading the way. And I bet that 50th was a real moment in time. And I just congratulate you for leading us down that bumpy road on your bus with us all tooting the horn for you. Debbie, you are a phenomenal woman, and I'm so grateful that you took the time to spend with us today. So thank you.
Thank you, Holly.
Thank you for joining me today. If you've enjoyed this episode, can I ask that you share it with a friend and like, subscribe and review it too, so that together we can inspire even more people to follow their dreams to build a life they love.